There'll be copies circulating for everyone who wants to see our leader stand.
Excellencies of Foreign Mission, Chairman of Associated Newspapers of Ceylon Limited, Sikhavan Patnaik, members of the panel, members of the Vijayawardena family, editors and other journalists, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I have been asked to speak a few words on D.R. Vijayawardena's family perspective, which I confess I find a bit of a daunting task. Limited as I am to bearing his initials, a distinction I bear with another cousin of mine, who, however, has the advantage of a recollection of our grandfather, which I regretfully do not. Be that as it may, having lived in the house which was my grandfather's home from 1937 to when he died in June 1950, D.R. Vijayawardena was a palpable presence to my siblings and to me, as it must have been to every member of his immediate family, and perhaps even more so to my many cousins who were actually born in Warrington, as our home was known. My grandfather's office room, with books, cupboards, and the desk that he used, all contributed to that presence. Not to mention his favorite vintage Mercedes, which resides in some splendor at the Gangaram, the family temple. The whole emphasis of D.R. Vijayawardena's professional life was to rid Sri Lanka of colonial occupation and gain independence. He believed in order to do this, an independent media, free from interference, was a prerequisite. He was a liberal who decided to name his first newspaper, Ceylon Daily News, after the London liberal newspaper, the Daily News. His Buddhist upbringing firmly set the stage for his determination that the fight for independence should be non-violent. He was elected as the secretary of the Ceylon National Association on 23rd October 1913, which was the precursor of the Ceylon National Congress that finally presented, through its leader, D.S. Nayaka, the Salisbury Constitution to the State Council on the 8th of November 1945 for unanimous approval. That in effect paved the way for independence without bloodshed. The riots of 1915 saw many prominent Sinhala leaders and businessmen, including D.R.'s elder brother, imprisoned by the colonial rulers for no apparent reason. This led D.R. into being a newspaper proprietor in order to educate and inform the public of the need for independence. Throughout the rest of his life, he remained fiercely independent and committed to report the truth as he saw for the primary purpose of educating and informing the public. The success of his newspaper is a testament to the dedication to his vocation and his business acumen in ensuring timely national circulation. The institution for which he was known, the Associated Newspapers of Ceylon Limited, or Lake House, had been acquired by Mrs. Sirimau Bandaranaike's government well before I was born. At a time when there was no TV and radio was a state enterprise, the influence of a privately owned state media was considered unhealthy. And particularly when a newspaper publishing house belonged to a family, the NCL Special Provisions Act transferred a controlling interest into the hands of the public trustee, who was Mrs. Bandaranaike's brother, evoked no strong dissent. Lake House was a family concern from inception. All the members of the Helena Vijayawardena family own government shares in it. He said Vijayawardena joined DR to buy the denominators. And Dr. Don Edmund gave up promising medical practice to work full-time with his brother at AMCR. Majority of ownership lay with DR as the founder, and he was unquestionably the driving force of the institution. Consequently, it's his family who felt the loss of Lakers, most not simply as a deprivation of a profitable family icon, but a far deeper feeling of the loss of something fundamental to the future of good governance of this country. It was this particular sense of loss that I have heard my father say led him to venture on into newspaper publishing again on his own, in an attempt to compensate in some measure for what was lost during his tenure of office in Lake House. This led, ironically, to his purchase of the titles of newspapers belonging to the Times of Ceylon, Lake House arch-rival of that era. The government's acquisition of Lake House caused another family member, Palit Vijayawardena, to launch a brand new set of newspapers, which were an instant success. However, all said and done, I would submit that the influence of ownership matters less than the media role today. People have a choice as never before as to which media they would repose their trust, whether print, electronic, or social media. And the trust will ultimately depend, as it must for us politicians as well, on credibility. Media, whether TV, radio, or newspapers, seem to have had a particular fascination for D.R. Vijayawardena's family. These include Shyam Vikramasinghe's pioneering efforts in TV, his brother Niraj's work in radio, and even I was sent to graduate, postgraduate studies in City University in London. I'm happy to know that Savan Vijayawardena, a great grandson and journalist in his own right, is now in ANCR2. I must admit, though the takeover of Lake House happened way before my time, I too share the sense of loss felt by my father and other members of my family. That feeling was enhanced when I walked into Lake House premises for the first time last Wednesday to attend the almsgiving organized by the chairman and staff members of the ANCL. However, I feel relieved and content knowing that Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe has placed the leadership of ANCL on the very capable hands of Mr. Kavan Ratnayak. In a very short time, Kavan has managed to bring back to Lake House the dignity that was lost in previous years. I have no doubt that he will bring Lake House to the high standard that it once enjoyed and will probably be a formidable competitor to our publishing house. I thank you, Kavan, for inviting me for this occasion. To conclude, I can only say that D.R. Vijayawardena has set an example of a single-minded effort for public good. He has left a difficult act to follow, but something we all can aspire to do. Thank you.
I'd like to acknowledge and welcome the family who is here, the Vijayawardena family. And I think leading the team today. So, thank you once again for being here. And I'd like to thank everyone else for coming at short notice. I think the invitations went out last week, and we're really glad that all of you could come at such short notice. I'd like to thank the panel who will speak today for their contribution. Look forward to a very interesting discussion there. And also my team, Savan and Madara and the rest who put this event together for helping out and being such a committed team. I've been in this seat for about a year now, and there's a very large picture of Mr. D.R. Vijayawardena on my wall. Ranjit is not here today, but it's that same nose. And, he stares at me all day, and I really don't know what to make of that look, but it's
look of, you know, what it is, but it's a stern look, and it's there, and I keep asking myself the question, what is it that DRW would do if he was here today? And part of this panel discussion would, I think, address that. But to add my two cents worth to this, it comes from a business end. And I'll say this and shut up and sit down, but basically, from what I've read and what I've seen, this was not a timid man. He was extremely bold. And basically, he dealt with the major issues of the day. So if he was here today, I think he would have dealt with some of the major issues, such as governance, such as unemployment, and such as unity. The second thought that crosses my mind is, whatever he does, he would have solved this problem and also made money in the process. Because he had the knack of really being a good business person. He would have associated thought leaders of today. Because his friends, he really counted the leading thought leaders of the day at that time. Whether it was in the UK or India, he associated with the best. And also, the other fact that really comes through is he was not afraid to use technology. He used technology with great gusto. So he would have leaned into, I think, he would have for sure bought a TV station or two, he would have bought radio, he would have been on Facebook, and whatever, but also he may have tackle issues like unemployment and, you know, expanded his empire. So, with that, I mean, the rest of it is really, you know, the media angle is up to the panel. I was just approaching it from the business angle and 30,000 feet. I think that's what he would have done. He's a great example. He's been followed by some very capable family members. I think Pali Vijayawardhan was one. And I believe Ranjit Vijayawardhan is another. My association with Ranjit Vijayawardhan is long standing, but from a distance. It took him 20 years to nod at me. I would see him in temple every Wednesday and every Saturday, and it was after 20 years that he nodded. And I think after about 25 years that he said hello. So it takes a while to make his acquaintance, but once you do, and I think the family traditions are being carried through. I see another media empire being built, and I wonder when he's going to buy his TV station. Anyway, having said that, gentlemen, I hope you enjoy today's proceedings. I hope the panel discussion is a vigorous one. Thank you for coming today and supporting both Lake House and the media industry.